Okay, it looks like we're starting to get some attendees coming through. So we'll make a start. So just welcome. Yeah, I'm Alex Payne, so lead consultant for Energy Advisory. As you're aware, this year has been a considerably difficult time for energy markets, particularly over the past few months. The markets have reached record highs with prices changing in 10% on a day-to-day basis. Today, we're discussing our view of where they've been and where we think that was going to drive the markets for the next coming 6 months. So shortly, I'm going to hand over to Damien Cox, who is our senior energy analyst, to look at our views of non-commodity costs, and then to Alan Whitefield, our research manager, to discuss wholesale commodity pricing. You can submit questions throughout using the Q&A box, and we'll answer as many as we can at the end of the session. We'll also let you have access to the slides via a download or a link after the webinar is completed. So firstly, whilst proactive risk management can help mitigate against market spikes, it's the here and now that is more difficult to manage. So Mitie are committed to helping customers to not only reduce their carbon through sustainability consulting, but also help them to reduce costs through building optimization and energy efficiency projects. We can also support with green technology, such as rooftop solar, energy efficient lighting, and larger carbon reducing projects, such as air source heat pumps and electric vehicle rollouts. So as always, if there's any areas that you would like to find out more about, please do not hesitate to get in touch. Likewise, you can contact us to subscribe to one of our many market intelligence packages to give you daily, weekly, and monthly updates on what's changing in the market from a pricing and policy perspective. So with that, I'll hand over to Damien Cox to talk about non-commodities. Thank you.
Thanks, Alex. Hi, good morning, everybody. Yes, my name is Damien Cox. I'm one of the analysts who work in technical reporting. And what we do is support you with energy market research. And we look at developments in non-commodities and also undertake a lot of budget work for everybody. So what I wanted to do this morning with you is share our thoughts on where we think non-commodities are heading over the summer. So we'll start off by having a gentle introduction into what non-commodity charging is. So we'll look at cost breakdowns and we'll discuss what the pricing model is before delving a little deeper into each non-commodity and the outlook over the summer. And then, as I'm sure you're all be aware, it's been a fantastically busy few years in the regulation space with some key developments kicking off in April and also some big policy announcements only this week. So we'll round up the session by having a look at those. So let's crack on. So this slide shows the increasing complexity of non-commodities. You can see there over the last 10 years or so, the increase in different support costs for helping deploy the transition to low carbon energy. And it's set to increase over the medium term. So some of you may have seen this slide before. We've moved it on a year, and in putting the slide together, some really interesting aspects leapt out at us. I think some of you will be aware that non-commodity charges like the renewables obligation and the feed-in tariff are fairly stable, easy to predict, but they're linked to RPI. So one of the big factors that we're considering when we model these non-commodity charges is what level of inflation to work on. So you can see there's a spike in 23, which reflects our thoughts on a high rate of inflation. So we're looking at RPI of about 7 or 8%. You can also see in the chart there that there's a big leap up in the cost of balancing over the medium term. So we'll come on to talk about that later on in the presentation. And what's really interesting is right at the top, you can see there the the impacts that a year's had on the contracts for difference scheme. So if you remember during the pandemic, there were real concerns about whether the scheme had enough funds in it to pay the generators, and the low carbon contracts company had to go to the government to get a loan. Well, it's inverted now. The strike prices are far below where wholesale prices are now, and that means that suppliers are receiving payments from generators. And that's really important, because you want to make sure that your suppliers are passing all the costs that you're entitled to on, back to you. So all the revenues from CFDs should be coming back to you. So it's important to check bills and have a proper bill validation process in operation. So look, if we move on, we'll just touch upon this slide here, which shows basically the way that costs are apportioned. So you can see there we've got our denominator, which is national demand, and our numerator, which are the scheme costs. So basically one divided by the other equals the unit rates. So lots of variables for lots of different schemes. So you've got allowed revenue for things like network charges, the green support costs, therefore renewables obligation and CFDs. CFDs are also impacted by wholesale prices. And we've got other factors like the economy and the weather, and energy efficiency. So this slide is really good in explaining the way that costs are divided and apportioned and allocated. And later on in the presentation, we're going to come back to this, because as I said, there's been a really big policy announcement this week affecting balancing charges that some of you might be aware of. So we'll come on to that in due course. But let's talk about demand now. And this chart here shows the long-term decline in demand, pretty much driven by gains in energy efficiency. You can see there the pandemic year when demand collapsed, very low levels of demand as the economy shut down because of the moves to combat the spread of the virus. We've got an uptick in 2021, but then we've got a lot of uncertainty about demand this year, not least because of the high wholesale prices that are impacting on the economy, and concerns about demand destruction. Real issues there. The other thing to note is that if scheme costs stay the same and demand falls, then charging base shrinks. That means the unit rates are going to be higher. So let's just talk about what's going to happen this summer. So similar levels of demand this year to last year. Weather is always a big driver. Impacts significantly on the transmission system, principally because of the way that affects embedded generation. So that's your wind and solar plants, which are connected at a local level. So that's really, really important. Bank holidays are important, and we're all looking forward to the Platinum Jubilee weekend this June. So that's a 2-day holiday. So that's going to have a big impact on demand. But I think the main thing to note is that concerns about demand are not as bad as they were during a pandemic year. Fairly similar patterns of demand 1 year or next. So great, provides greater certainty about non-commodity prices. So let's have a look at these non-commodities then. So I think we're going to start off by having a look at balancing charges. So, chart says it all, doesn't it? Extremely high balancing costs over this summer. So I think the thing to remember here is that balancing costs are linked to the wholesale price of energy. If you have too much wind generation in one part of the network, trying to get to another part of the network, it can't, because of physical constraints in infrastructure. That means the grid has to manage it, has to intervene, tell the wind generators to turn off, and then ask gas-fired generators to switch on to generate power to send it to where it's needed. So I guess the point is that even if the level of intervention this summer remain the same as it did last summer, the costs are going to be higher because of the increase in wholesale energy prices. So yeah, no two ways about it. It's a very volatile non-commodity charge, very difficult to predict, and impacted by the cost of energy. So a real increase in balancing costs this year. And we'll talk about what's going to happen to balancing over the medium term towards the end of the session. So look, before we do, let's move on. Let's talk about the contracts for difference scheme. So whereas we have very high balancing costs, the contracts for difference scheme is going completely the other way. So you remember I started off talking about CFDs and the strike price. So the strike price is the price that scheme participants get paid to deploy large-scale low-carbon projects. So strike price will guarantee the generator a certain level of revenue. If the wholesale market is lower than a strike price, then generators get topped up. But as we've seen over the last year or so, wholesale prices are much higher than a strike price. So the opposite is true. So generators will start paying suppliers. So the suppliers should start paying their customers. So as I said, it's really important, make sure that you've got a proper bill validation process in place, which is capturing that revenue coming back to you. So the chart, yeah, basically shows that the low carbon contracts company doesn't believe there is a need for generators, suppliers to pay generators over the next year or so, which means that the interim levy rate has been set at zero. So it may be that it probably is the case that the reconcile rate, which is the rate which is known after the event, is negative now. So it may be cold comfort that you should be getting money back from suppliers. So in terms of policy developments affecting the CFD scheme this year, we had the fourth allocation round launched in December, closed in January, and we're expecting the results of that round to be published over the next few months. So it'll be very interesting to see what strike prices have been negotiated. That's going to be really important. And also, the government is moving towards annual auctions from next April. Another policy development affects the treatment of imports from the EU. So when this scheme was launched, along with the feed-in tariff scheme, back in the day, special treatment had to be made for imports from neighbouring countries so that the scheme had to comply with state aid rules. But since we've left the European Union, those rules no longer apply. So the government is considering removing the exemption. So what the effect of that would be is that it would increase it would widen the charging base, and that would mean that the unit costs are expected to be lower. Okay, so if we can move on to next slide. Okay, so feed-in tariffs, again, highly seasonal. So you can see there that tariffs are higher in the summer months than they are in the winter, principally because most of the generation mix in the scheme is made up of solar, so highly seasonal. The scheme is linked to RPI, as well. So whilst it's relatively easy to try and predict the trend, we have to consider what level of RPI we need to model using the model. So again, we're considering higher rates of RPI now of around 7 to 8%, and a similar fashion. Government wants to remove the exemption from imports of EU renewables. So what that has, what the effect of that has, is that it increases the share of demand for each supplier's share of demand. So demand is greater, so the scheme costs are relatively stable, then unit rates are going to be lower in that case. So let's crack on and have a look at capacity market auction. So I think there was great interest with the T1 auction that took place in February, not least because of the increase in fuel input and pollution costs. So this auction is the top-up auction for maintaining energy security for the coming winter. Very interesting to note there that the scheme cleared at a record price of £75 a kilowatt a year. That was actually it cleared in the first round at the ceiling. Very, very expensive capacity procured, reflecting the high price of wholesale gas. So looking at the results, you can see there that most of the participants who were awarded contracts were existing generators and they burned gas. So yeah, there's no two ways about it. It's the high cost of energy feeding through to another non-commodity. And then when you compare the auction results for this top-up auction with the T3 auction, and also the additional long-term capacity that was procured in previous auctions, it's very expensive per unit of capacity. So let's have a look at what that means for peak prices this winter. So we're edging up towards £75 a megawatt hour there. So up from about £60 for the winter just gone, but not as high as the 125 plus that we saw for the previous year. Looking forward over the medium term, we do expect higher capacity prices, not least because of the high cost of energy, but also because of changes in the generation mix. So we're looking at the closure of old nuclear units, so reduction in capacity there. So that narrows the level of spare capacity, so places a premium on scarcity. So we anticipate that peak rates will be higher over the medium term. So if you can respond flexibly, then you can limit your exposure to this non-commodity. So let's have a look at transmission charges. Okay, so there's a lot of reform around transmission and distribution at the moment, and we'll talk about that in the last part of the presentation. But for now, you can see there are big increases in the half hourly rates, 7% to £55, and then the residual, which makes up most of the half hourly tariff, especially in zones in the Midlands and in the south of England. That's also increased as well. So obviously you pay for transmission if you're a half hourly customer through triads. Main reason for the increase in prices has been the rise in allowed revenue that the networks can recover. So obviously inflation features in that as well. So over the winter months, you've probably been bombarded on a daily basis by triad notifications. So telling you to reduce loads if you can, or letting you know that there's likely to be a triad. That's going to continue for one more winter. but the regime in its current form comes to an end next April. We'll talk about that in a second. So moving on. Okay, so we're getting towards the end of this middle section on non-commodities. So renewables obligation, largest green support scheme that the UK has, about 35 gigawatts of capacity, and that's reflected in the scale of the charges. So we're looking about 25, 26 pounds a megawatt hour to pay for these green support costs. So completely different to the CFD scheme, which is a much more nuanced way of deploying large renewable generation projects. RO scheme is also impacted heavily by mutualization. So mutualization costs have risen to very, very high levels, as I think it was 28, 29 suppliers went bust. So the costs of that, the difference in the shortfall in the scheme is made up by socializing those costs across the remaining suppliers. So that also adds to the cost of the renewables obligation. But there has been scheme reforms taking place over the last year or so. So the mutualization threshold has now increased to the equivalent of 1% of the scheme cost. So that equates to about 66 million pounds. As you can see, that still wouldn't have been enough to prevent mutualization last year, which was the fourth year in a row that this had been triggered. Okay, so let's turn to look at the hydro levy. So relatively stable non-commodity cost, and also fairly small. You can see there that the step up in the rate to 40p a megawatt hour last year as a result of the inclusion of the cross subsidy scheme for the Shetland Islands. It is index linked to inflation, so RPI of 7% means the scheme will be relatively more expensive over in 23-24 compared to where we are this year, about 40p a megawatt hour. So let's have a look at some policy developments now. So I'm going to talk first of all about the tenures reform. So as you're probably aware, the structure of your distribution tariffs have changed from the 1st of April with the implementation of a new fixed capacity charge. Ofgem now wants to apply a fixed daily capacity charge to to recover the demand residual from April 23. So this effectively means that those users who have been employing triad avoidance measures are unlikely to, well, they won't be able to do so from April 23. It doesn't necessarily mean the end of triads, because the locational element of the tariff will still be based on volumetric charging. That locational element itself, though, has been floored at zero pounds a kilowatt and zero pence a kilowatt hour. And the reason why Ofgem has decided to do that, as obviously you know that in the north of England and in Scotland, there are some consumers who will actually receive a credit. Well, that's going to go. And the reason why Ofgem wants to do that is it keeps the residual cost lower for all consumers. So transmission charges are made up of a combination of a forward-looking element, which is locational, and also the residual, hence the term, which allows them to recover the remainder of their allowed revenue. So triads are going to go, not disappear completely, but there will be a fundamental reform kicking in next April. And over the medium term, Ofgem is also considering how it can address other areas of reform affecting transmission, and it's asked National Grid to launch a task force to look at certain causes of unpredictability in its charges, so that they can remain cost reflective. Okay, so moving on to talk about distribution. So the TCR reforms to the distribution demand residual came into effect from the 1st of April. So tariff structure changes. The time of use tariffs are still there, but they are lower. They're offset by the introduction of a capacity charge to ensure that everybody pays their fair share of network charges. But that isn't the end of distribution reform. There's a few projects which are going on at the moment. Ofgem has decided to launch a DUOS significant code review, which is going to look at all aspects of the charging structure. So this has now been separated out from the access and forward looking SCR, which looks at connections. This DUOS SCR will look at the way that the tariff structure operates. So it's going to look, on the one hand, it's going to look at your volumetric charges, your variable charges. So that's your red, amber, green time of use tariffs. And it's also going to look at capacity, the way that is charged as well. So work has already started on that. It's expected to proceed over the next 18 months to 2 years. But any reforms are unlikely to be implemented until 2025 at the earliest, because Ofgem wants to ensure that it can implement reforms to the access and forward-looking co-review from next April. So that co-review looks at the way that customers can access the distribution networks. So it wants to create a much more flexible system to accommodate moves to net zero. So it's going to be looking at considering things like shared access and what have you, but it's also looking at removing some of the costs associated with connecting at that level, because it was concerned that they could be an impediment to net zero. So when you're connecting, sometimes you have to pay an upfront charge for any reinforcement work to the network as part of your connection. So it's looking at that, but it also wants to impose a cost cap so that other consumers aren't unfairly disadvantaged. Okay, so let's have a look at our last area of reform. This is Pursue Us, balancing charges. So remember, right at the start, we showed that we had that picture of the way that scheme costs are calculated. We had our denominator, which was the level of demand, and a numerator, which was the scheme costs. So this is a perfect example of that. So Ofgem has decided this week that it wants to remove the Pursue Us charge from generators. So currently, demand users and generators both pay for balancing the transmission system. However, generators on the continent don't do that. And also, there are very small generators in the GB market who also don't pay, which disadvantages large generators. So Ofgem wants to remove that distortion and has decided that it wants to move the total costs over to the demand side. So that effectively means that the charging base for demand is cut in half, because generators pay 47% of the share of generation is 47%, it's 53% for demand users. So if you load it all onto one type of customer, then effectively doubles the unit rate for Pursuer. So we're going to be going from, you know, an average of £9 a year this year to, well, effectively £18. Ofgem has said, though, that it will have a beneficial impact on the RO and the CFD schemes, because it means that generators wouldn't pay the sewer charges. So we talked about AR4 a little while ago for the fourth allocation round. So those participants hoping to win contracts, their strike prices are going to be lower now, because they won't be paying Basuos. And it also means that capacity market auctions will actually reflect true costs rather than differences between different types of generation. Right, I am very conscious of the time. I will get things wrapped up so that Alan can take over. So I'm just going to finish off now by saying that there's a few things that you can take to reduce risk. So energy optimization is one. So obviously you've got risk management policies in place, but also policies to monitor your energy consumption as well. If you can, take advantage of some of the government schemes that shield business from non-commodity costs, and continue to monitor developments. If you're employing a consultancy like us, well, engage with us. We've got a fantastic wealth of knowledge. We're looking at this day in, day out. We've only scratched the surface this morning in terms of non-commodities. So there's a lot of reform that's taking place. And I've spoken to a few of you now, and I think a number of you are interested in workshops. So that's certainly something that we can look at doing. Right, I really am conscious of the time now. So without further ado, I'll say goodbye and I'll hand over to Alan. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Damien. That was really interesting as always. I'm the Mitie Energy Research Manager, and I'm going to take you through the commodity outlook. What the markets have been doing over the last 12 months, it'll feel like 12 years. And then we have a view on the supply and demand fundamentals going forward in the months ahead, and how that's going to impact prices both this summer, the winter 22, and then into 2023 and beyond. So this starting slide is demonstrating how the near term and the prompt impacts the mid curve, say the Q3 and the winter 22, and how that impacts the forward curve as well. And sometimes the front of the market and the prompt supply and demand that dictates how the forward curves trade, and they trade sort of in parallel, and they have the same movements every day. Other times, geopolitical factors influence more the macro and the longer term trends that push and pull the back around, and that ends up influencing the front. And over the last 6 months, we've seen the market swing from everything being focused on the front with the fears of immediate gas and power shortages in the near term. That spread through to longer term security supply issues. And now it looks like we've got weaker fundamentals at the front, more supply than demand, and the problems have been pushed further down the line, with the 2023-2024 contract seeing a premium. So we'll go into the reasons for that a bit later on. But if we start with looking backwards and try and tackle in a brief summary what the hell has happened in the gas market over the last 12 months. So if you turn on your TV or open a newspaper, read news online, on social media, it's been possible to avoid the energy crisis and reading about the energy crisis. And unusually, it's been headline news in the mainstream media for months now. Even before the terrible events in Ukraine, we were in a tricky situation globally and locally. And it was already leading to exceptionally high retail prices for households and for businesses. So I wanted to summarize this with a slightly different take and imagine the last 12 months as a series of films. So if we look back 12 months ago to April last year, this was the sort of the genesis of the story. This is the big start. This is Global Gas Crisis Part One. And this film had a big budget, it had lots of hype, it had a really strong plot. Now, it should be said there was actually a prequel to this film, a backstory for the looming crisis. But this has been well covered in the winter outlook 6 months ago, as I said, in all the press, and even 12 months ago in our last Mitie Energy summer outlook. So we don't need to hear any more about the start of the pandemic, the lost gas supply. We've kind of moved forward from that. So back to the blockbuster, the first in our series of films, Global Gas Crisis One. And our story starts 12 months ago when the world was a much nicer place. We've come out of the winter with half decent gas storage levels. The global energy situation was pretty balanced. Then we had week after week of really cold temperatures. And it wasn't quite the day after tomorrow, but certainly there was inclement weather and lots of it. And the story built and built, and the weather impact spread and caused more problems across the globe. So it wasn't just a frosty May day in the Cotswolds that was an issue. It was all of Europe drawing down on gas storage stocks exactly at the time when they should be building them up. And it was very cold in Asia too, so it was depleting their stocks of LNG, liquefied natural gas. And then it was very dry in Brazil, so they had no hydroelectric power. They had to import record volumes of LNG by ship. Then things flipped on their head, and Asia turned from too cold to too hot. By July, parts of China, South Korea, and Japan were importing record levels of LNG just to keep cool. And we saw the horrific high temperatures and situations with wildfires in North America up to Canada. But Southern Europe also had it really bad, with hot weather sending air conditioning power demand soaring. And then the wind stopped blowing, and we had lots of lovely new wind turbines that just weren't turning. So this is turning out to be a disaster movie. It's numerous weather events that have led to a big finale with sapped energy supplies across Europe. And that's exacerbated the low storage situation. At this point, you can introduce a subplot, which I've called Where is the Russian Gas? And that plot may actually resurface in a sequel to this film. There was hardly any Gazprom supply going into European storage, and there was no real amounts of Russian gas fueling European power stations. And this led to a crescendo, you can see right in the middle of the chart, into October. And this is the final act of this film, which saw record-breaking prices. And gas that was 50p at the start of the movie is now six times higher. But wait, the most unlikely hero arrives, and it's Vladimir Putin claiming that his Nord Stream 2 pipeline is ready to supply all the gas that Europe needs. Russia announced that they're turning on the taps. They're joining in with the new LNG good guys, ready to flood the Europe with gas ships. A happy ending ensues. In the middle of October, the market was down 50%. Crisis is over, roll the credits. But of course, there was a sequel, and this was a much shorter film. Shift forward a few weeks towards the end of November, and you had hero turned villain, Putin, and Russia holding the EU to ransom to get Nord Stream 2 approved. Didn't work. And this was at a time of extreme cold when we got to the start of December, second week of December. And there was a real threat then of gas shortages in Germany. There was a threat of blackouts in France. But then the weather turned, and the weather became the savior. With the help of Captain Joe Biden and his armada of LNG ships from the States, the gas price collapsed. This turns out to be a Christmas movie, because by New Year, we had a record low demand, and prices had fallen 60% from the highs that we'd seen just over a week ago, just before Christmas. But there was a cliffhanger in the end. The Russian threat hadn't gone away, and Putin's troops remained camped on the Ukraine border. Now, I need to jump in here and mention the fact that we had a few spin-off movies during this period, spin-offs of the franchise. They were films that weren't as sexy or as exciting, didn't grab attention of mainstream media, but they did show how the market could fall. The story was of actual high supply from Norway and from LNG, and low demand with warmer than normal temperatures and dropping industrial demand. And prices at times crashed off because the underlying fundamentals were weak, and but that didn't really grab the headlines, and we didn't read about them. It didn't make for a good plot. So that brings us to the last part of this trilogy. And this was, sadly, a war story. The invasion of Ukraine and the threat of sanctioned gas or a Gazprom shutdown sent gas prices spiking to 800 pence per therm. That's 20 times what they were a year ago. Despite the atrocities continuing on the ground and the war rumbling on, and despite Rublegate and arguments on payments and more sanctions being talked about and built up, the market actually came down, and came down quite quickly. It was only 800p for a number of hours, got down to 500p, which is still ridiculously expensive, and then kept on coming down. So all this LNG carried on coming in, much of it from the US, and mild weather overall has prevailed. So the markets kept on coming in decline. So are we at the end of this movie? Is this the end of the trilogy? Well, we're certainly in the final act. Is there a happy ending? Well, it doesn't look that happy, certainly not if you're Ukrainian. And certainly not for consumers. But will there be a twist in the end? Well, it is possible, because the grand finale of this trilogy is playing out right now. And we'll come to the fundamentals and how that's impacting price in a minute. Now on to power. And I'm afraid I don't have any more analogies. And even if I did, we don't have the time. So, and a very similar story to gas and what we've described in those films. But there's additional bullish drivers with power. What about the French nuclear outages, which were drawing in a lot of imports into France from surrounding countries. We've had long periods of low wind speeds that have resulted in gas and even coal generation ramping up here and in Germany. And prices have really, really rocketed up from £60 up to £600. And we've also seen some super high balancing prices in the near-term market, especially in Europe. And also we have our old friend carbon with fairly consistent rising trend all through the year. So what could change for this summer for electricity? Can the fundamentals help bring cheaper prices? Well, if we look at power demand, it's actually in decline, and Damien mentioned that earlier. And on this slide, we can see that the deep purple line, which is the only gets lower when we look back historically in the times of the COVID lockdowns. So contrary to last year's picture, when we saw annual growth in demand, the bounce back from COVID, we're seeing the opposite now. And in 2022, we've seen power demand decline. And it's only partially to do with weather. The inflationary pressures with high costs of energy are having an impact on industrial production, both here and on the continent. And don't get me wrong, it has been sunnier and we've got more rooftop solar. So we've got more embedded generation, as Damien mentioned earlier. So household consumption is on average lower, but everyone in the country, everyone across Europe, every business is already being or soon will be as efficient as they possibly can to just try and reduce that electricity consumption. How many people on this call have looked at their smart meter a lot more in the past few weeks and just checking how much electricity they're using? It's becoming more and more critical every day. Now, with this lower demand, we could actually see things get into a tight spot this summer. The next chart on the screen shows National Grid and their summer outlook, and we have a trend for lower demand. But they also see a concern, and they have special measures in place, including the negative reserve active power margin. And these are key operability challenges, but they're not insurmountable. And these actions are in case this lower demand that we've talked about causes problems when we have an excess in power supply. And this excess in supply isn't anything to do with gas or to do with coal. It's not to do with nuclear. It's because of renewables. And yes, you can't guarantee how many days they're going to be windier than normal and how many days are going to be sunnier than normal. And crucially, how many days you're not going to get any sun or any wind if it's cloudy and still. But what you can say is that on an average day, on a windy day, you have much more capacity and you have more wind farms. You're going to get a hell of a lot more energy. And on the next slide, we can see how renewable capacity is coming online this year. Already, we've seen records broken for renewable generation. In January, we had high winds of up to 20 gigawatts of wind generation during the storms. So what happens when new projects come? And we've got Hornsea 2, the biggest offshore wind farm in the world, that's coming online in the middle of this year, 1.4 gigawatt mega project. And that's off the coast of Yorkshire. And by the end of 2022, it should be producing sort of up to maximum, producing enough electricity to power 1.3 million homes. As I said, the largest wind farm in the world. So this is a bit of a game changer. And as Boris Johnson and Kwasi Kwarteng have said, part of the long-term energy security plan is to have more and more offshore wind and maybe even some more onshore wind as well. So on a windy day this September, I'm really confident that the UK is going to smash a lot of these records for renewable electricity. And compared to last summer, when we had long periods without any wind, the year-on-year impact is going to be remarkable. And this extra wind helps free up a lot of other energy as well, namely gas, which we can store in mid-range storage and save it for a non-windy day. And the UK is well adept at that, been using that well for the last couple of years. And both with rooftop solar and solar parks, solar farms on the increase, a sunny and a windy day could be something special in terms of power supply this year. And that's going to grow year on year. Now, it's fine when it's sunny and it's fine when it's windy, but what about when it's not? Well, on the next slide, we can show what happens and how we're well connected to the rest of Europe for these days. And this morning, for example, we've only got 3% wind and 8% solar in the mix early this morning. We need 60% of our power supply today from gas and from coal. And imports, crucially, are that top up, that 3 to 4% at the top. Which is fine, because the UK is well connected, very well connected to our neighbours. We've got these orange bars on the chart, which typically show how much we're importing, how much proportion we import on each of these interconnectors down the bottom. How much we export is the blue pipe. There's the blue bar on the chart, and it's quite varied. It's quite. We've seen a good step up in that last year when we had the new North Sea link that connects us with Norway. So it allows us to import lots of low carbon power directly from Norway. And that's the longest subsea electric cable, the NSL. Now, the big exports on the chart, the blue, are mainly to Ireland. But the more interesting part and how that could develop this summer is the IFA1 and IFA2 connections with France, and then the new ELEC link, which is actually a cable that lies within the Channel Tunnel. So you might remember the IFA1 link had a bad fire in September in last year at a converter station in Kent. And part of that cable remains offline due to the extensive work needed to be done by National Grid. But the remaining capacity that's there across the other cables, we're likely to see, instead of importing near 100%, we'd like to see at times a lot more export to France. And the next slide shows why. The safety issues, extensive maintenance of an aging nuclear fleet, France are short of power. The availability that they've had on French nuclear capacity has been really, really hammered in recent months, and it's been the lowest it has been for several years. So until a lot of these units return to service and pass their safety checks and get fixed, France are quite exposed to periods of high demand and prone to price spikes. An extreme heat wave in France this summer would result in all the interconnectors importing as much as possible. And it might lead in France to some power rationing too. Might not be able to run as many air conditioning units as you might want when it's 40 degrees outside. But from a pricing perspective, on the next slide, it's the French impact and the impact of renewables and the impact of everything that we have. It's caused a big premium still at the front of winter, but that's going to erode if we don't see any extreme weather and if we have decent wind and decent sunshine. As I mentioned, a drop in gas and carbon prices like we've seen at the moment will certainly help winter power prices ease. And beyond that, we see a risk premium in the market to pay for both the transition away from fossil fuels and most recently the transition away from a reliance on foreign energy suppliers, especially Russia, being factored into the price. And this risk premium is going to stay for a few years yet, but it will diminish if things settle down this summer. We don't believe that power prices will fall to the long-term average on here. You can see that at just above 50 to 60 pounds per megawatt hour. We don't believe that prices are going to get down there, possibly never again in the long term. But there's a very good chance that prices over the next year or so will drop back down below that 100 pound per megawatt hour level, and they could stay down for a period of time before ramping back up again later on in the decade as electrification is spread through heat and through transport and demand actually increases again. But for now, we do see some downside, and the market's seeing that as well. So moving on to gas, demand for gas looks even weaker than power this year. Weather's been a big factor, especially year on year compared to the cold April and May that we had. But we've had a warmer than average Q1 as well. So we've got a few frosty nights at the moment, but nothing really like we saw last year. So demand is down significantly. Industrial demand across Europe for gas is down almost 10% year on year. And the UK is consuming between 10 and 20% less gas last year over the Jan to April period. The only area where demand is actually on the increase is long-range storage injections. And for the UK, without rough storage anymore, that means exporting gas to the continent and helping our EU neighbours fill their storage sites. Now, next slide shows a bit more about storage. This was all that anyone could talk about last summer, and it was a major issue. And the run into the winter 21, storage was a problem. And it's still problematic, but we have caught up in recent years. And you can see, not very clear on the chart, but just as we're coming into April, the black line at the bottom, which was very, very low over this winter, that's the volume that we have in storage, is rising again. And it's up, it's actually up now above 30%, about 32% across Europe. And the target is to get that up to 80% in October or even sooner. And several analysts, including Bloomberg, think that we could actually, with the following wind, we could actually be full across most storage sites by September. And that would, again, offer some comfort for this winter. UK storage is a bit different. I guess, as I said, we don't have rough, but we do have these mid-range storage facilities, which are used very well for shorter term and medium term fluctuations. And they're already at 70% full, well above what we had last year. So there's an element of comfort there. Now, onto the elephant in the room, we have to talk about Russia. And it should be said, UK doesn't have a reliance on Russian gas. Boris Johnson stood up in front of Parliament at the start of the conflict and said that Russia supplies 4% of the UK's gas. Well, it's not really 4%. It has been at times. And on this chart, you see the red, thick red line saying that on a percentage term, there was a bit of a spike in June. And the last time we had any meaningful amounts of Russian LNG was back in December, when it was coincidentally about 4%. But that's fallen and fallen significantly. In the summer months, we don't get anything from Russia in terms of LNG. And from now on, we're certainly not going to get anything from Russia. So the physical risk of losing Russian gas and losing Russian LNG is not there for the UK, but the commercial risk is there because we have to pay for alternatives. And you can see on that screen, the grey bar is the biggest alternative that both we have in the UK and what they have in Europe, which is LNG. And the cost of that LNG is set on the global market, as we know. So alternatives to Russian LNG are quite varied, and we can see that on the next slide for what we get in the UK. UK is in a much better position than Germany for gas supply. We're ahead of the curve. On the last slide, we'd seen the large bars for UK North Sea and Norwegian gas, but for the UK, it's LNG that's the big lead and the big ramp up that we've seen this year. Yeah, it has to be said, without Russian gas, Germany will suffer, and they'll suffer in the winter time without Russian gas. But we'll help them, and the rest of Europe will help them, and the US will help them. And we are exporting a lot through our interconnectors to Europe to help fill European storage. But for the moment, UK has enough supply. Enough supply from the North Sea, enough supply from Norway, especially from LNG. And this LNG is not just coming from the US, it's coming from Qatar, Nigeria, Trinidad, Peru, Algeria. It's coming from all over the world. So that diversification is good, and the UK is in a good place. And also remember, if there's too much LNG around, the UK is always the dumping ground because it's easy to bring it in here. We've got several terminals, it's easy to connect it to the market. So when there's too much LNG around like we had in Q2 2020, we'll get a lot. And that could happen again, but it might not be for some time. So if we look at demand on the next slide, Europe has seen a big decline in industrial demand. You can see that on the green line there. Many fertilizer plants and other factories using expensive gas have been mothballed. Demand is down. And as the headline says, with retail prices on the increase, even though our prices are capped, we've all seen increases in home and energy bills like never before. So behaviors are already changing. And they'll continue to change. We will use less gas because we can't afford to. And that brings us to the price. So the curve is too high, but as with power, we don't expect it to get back to normal. Not for quite some time. There is a potential for a price drop, as we said, in power. And gas has been massively impacted by recent events. So it has further to fall, in theory. When things are getting better and supply and demand is loosened up. And Europe, and for gas, there will continue to be a risk premium, as we can see on there, winter 22, a risk premium for the front winter, just in case it's cold. But summer prices have fallen, and May yesterday expired as a front month contract below 130 pence per therm. And remember, front month was up at 800 very briefly, 500 for a while, now it's down at 130. But the winter price is still high, and the winter price is still up around about 230. But if we avoid extreme weather and have decent wind and sunshine, and the LNG keeps coming in at the current rate, prices will continue to fall. And beyond that, we see the risk premium in the market that is necessary to pay for the transition away from foreign suppliers, Russia, and a transition towards low carbon. We also need that premium there in the forward prices to keep the gas away from Asia, the LNG away from Asia and heading our way. But as demand eases, and once the Russian regime and our reliance on it ends for good, then that risk premium will diminish. And again, like power, we don't believe gas prices will fall all the way down to that long-term average, 50, 60p. But they've got a lot to go. And with a huge global ramp up that we're seeing in gas and LNG production projects between 2024 and 2026, there's another gas glut glooming. But until then, lower demand is the best chance to finally bring gas prices back down below the 100 pence level, which we could see next year. So quickly, running out of time, we'll go on to carbon, which is a bullish story once more. More interesting over the last few months, where we can see speculators that have carried on with their investments into a one-way market right up until the start of the war, and traders fled to less risky assets. They also suffered margin calls on their positions, which led to a rapid release of carbon positions to save money for collateral so they could carry on trading and other assets on trading exchanges. And many or most hedge funds actually cashed in their chips and took profit when the price collapsed. And now we're back into this trading range. And we can see in the next screen, people talk a lot about carbon trading ranges. It's a very technical market. There's technical signals, upper and lower bands, we can see on the next slide. And we have upper lower prices around, you know, 75 as a floor, around 85 as a ceiling. And carbon really, really likes having a range bound market. This morning it jumped to 84 euros a ton, but it remains within that technical range. And as mentioned, this next slide shows how speculators play a big part in the analysis and shows how they shifted from long to short a few weeks ago. And the price moved accordingly. The EU is looking closely at how much involved speculators have in the market going forward. So that's one to watch. But the next slide just very briefly shows the UK market, a fledgling market. It doesn't really have any speculator involvement, but it's growing in size and importance. And structurally, it's changing as well. But the thing to highlight there is that what we've seen is UK emissions were up 4% in the year. EU emissions were actually up 9% in the year. But remember, that's a year-on-year increase because we're referencing that to 2020 and the lockdowns that we had back then. So in summary, the fundamentals for this summer are, for the moment, weak. The market's no longer tight. The EU and the UK are on the same path that they started on in early March, with a permanent removal of the reliance and influence of Putin and Russia on energy supplies. The timescale for this, for a complete removal of Russian influence, is variable, and it appears to be accelerating, at least this week, with the latest action and the latest rhetoric from Russia, from Germany and from others. Every EU country and EU collectively has been drawing up plans and contracting alternative supplies, as the UK has for some time now. And at some point in 2023, that reliance on Russia will be completely gone. But in the near term, some countries such as Germany just won't have enough alternative energy sources to replace the Russian gas imports. And a shut off this year will result in gas rationing and gas prices spiking, especially in Germany and other parts of the continent. But the UK is well protected from gas shortages, and many alternative energy sources are already available. But with extreme weather, the UK is still exposed to gas and power spikes over the coming year. Extreme heat in the summer, extreme cold at the start of winter. So demand destruction will be the key. And with long lasting energy efficiency measures, it should become more useful and more widely used as bills rise, then we will see an effect. If we use less gas, if we consume less electricity, and if we produce more from renewables, we'll start to get out of this energy crisis. Thank you. I'll hand you back to Alex.
Thank you, Alan. And thank you also to Damien. We've had a few questions coming in now, so I will just look over to those, and probably Alan, I think they're for you at the moment by the looks of things, most of them around Russia. So if we start with the first one, should the war end, how much risk premium do you see coming out of the market?
I'm glad I stopped the video there because I pulled a face when you mentioned Russia. I'm not really don't want to get into politics, but yes, there's a risk premium there. As I mentioned before the conflict, and before so much saber rattling from from Putin sort of in the fourth quarter last year, there was still a risk premium in the price. Most, I'd say at the front, most of the risk premium for Russia has come out already. It's the back end of the curve. It's winter 22 and beyond. There's still a decent chunk. So I would give a bold prediction, but also a bit woolly as well, with lots of caveats as necessary. If the Russian conflict ended and we had normal weather, we didn't have any extremes, and we have some demand correction, as we mentioned in there, then in theory, going forward, prices could halve from where we are. We've seen that in times in the past when there's been a fundamental change to the prices, the market come down as quickly as it went up. But there's a lot that has to happen for that, and for that risk premium to come out. There will be a risk premium, or a premium certainly, as we mentioned, for the years going on, because we're not going to fall back into bed with Russia, and we're not going to turn back on the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. And companies like Centrica, I can't imagine, are going to turn around and go, oh, we're friends with Russia again, and we're going to sign Gazprom deals. So there'll still be a premium in there to get to allow us to get gas from alternative sources. It'd just be diminished when the war's over.
Okay. And then kind of on the flip side, so if the crisis continues for many months or longer, is there a prospect that wholesale gas prices fall further from these levels?
Every month that goes on, every week that goes on, the EU, UK, others are finding alternatives to Russian energy. So that reliance and the impact that Putin has with his headlines grabbing statements, and that Russia have, or Gazprom have, with their actions of turning off the taps, that impact is diminished every week that goes on. So in theory, the war could rumble on. It would be a horrible situation, but the energy market is moving on rapidly. And the European Commission said earlier this week that the time has already come, to move away from Russia and move away from their influence. And just on the pricing aspect, when we had top BBC headline was Poland and Bulgaria being shut off on Wednesday, and the market spiked 20%, which made another headline. And then within an hour, 2 hours, the market was back down and is now significantly lower than that level now at the front. So the risk premium is there for moments, but there's not really a huge reaction yet. It would have to be something seismic, a seismic development from Russia to mixed with unclement weather to see prices really spike back up again.
Okay. Then we have a question around EU storage levels. So do we feel they'll be full in time for October, November deadlines?
Yeah, the November deadline is actually, you know, with all things being equal, the November deadline is highly achievable. When we've looked at 80%, the deadline for November going forward in subsequent years is going to be 90%. Which is a much more comfortable level. But 80% in November should be fine. There's a chance that a lot of the storage sites will be 100% full by the end of September, because the incentives are there and the gas is there to inject at the moment. Remember, last year we didn't have as much LNG coming in, so there was less spare gas around to put into storage. And we had a lot of the storage under Russian control last year, which is now not the case, because the German government have taken control of some of it. So if things go to plan, then we should be full. We should be full in October or November.
Okay. And a question: if the EU bans Russian gas completely, will the UK need to ration gas consumption across industry?
I don't believe so. I don't believe there's a physical risk anymore, because we're prepared for it. There might be some rationing of exports potentially in an emergency situation. But provided the LNG keeps coming into UK terminals, provided Norway keeps sending as much gas to the UK, and provided the UK upstream, UK continental shelf keeps producing, then physically we should have enough gas. The issue is much more on the border with Russia, as we've seen with Poland and Bulgaria.
Okay, and if the EU were to sanction Russian gas, how high could energy prices get to, or gas prices get to, and do we see that happening over the next few months?
As I said, the impact of flows stopping Bearing in mind they haven't stopped totally, so we haven't seen that sanctioning really come out or have an impact. The impact of that happening is diminishing all the time. So if the threat was there for a complete cessation of Russian gas supplies back in March at the start of the conflict, that sent us to 500 to 800 pence per therm. That was the cost that the market was willing to put on all Russian gas suddenly vanishing during a period of cold weather. So we're not going to be in that situation because we're not going to see a cold demand spike over the next few months. And by the time we get there, hopefully not until maybe December, there'll be enough alternatives in place to replace most of the gas. So if it happens in the summer, it's not an issue. If it happens in the winter with full sanctions, as it very well could do, Western Europe should be fine. Again, it should be Germany that haven't quite got everything in place to replace all Russian gas, and they're the ones that will suffer. So there'll be on complete sanctions, there will be price rises, yes, particularly in the near term, but we won't see anything like the spikes that we saw last year.
And I need to bring Damien back in. We've got a question on non-commodities for you. So we've got the FIT has been replaced with a smart export guarantee. Is there a possibility that customers might pay for the coexistence of the two schemes before the FIT is fully out of the market in 2027?
That's a very interesting question. I'll be honest, I'm not sure of the answer on that. So I would have to take that away and research that. So I'm sorry about that. I don't have an answer for you on that.
No problem. That's all the questions we've had so far. I don't know if anyone else wants to add any more to the question and answer tab, but if there are, give you a few more seconds to put some through. No, it seems like we've exhausted the questions. So it just leaves me to say, you know, thank you very much for attending. We hope you've enjoyed the session and that it's been informative for you and given you a view on where we think prices are going to go over the next 6 months. If you need to obviously contact us, we've got email addresses there. You can contact any of us through LinkedIn or by email. And have a fantastic weekend and look forward to seeing you next time. Thanks very much.